In this video, we're looking at static factories in Java, coming up next. Imagine we're creating a class to represent coordinates. The coordinates could be two numbers representing the x and y axis, or the two numbers can represent a length and an angle. Think about that for a second. This breaks because our constructor will only have the two numbers for parameters, and no way to guess which one you mean. You could say integers for one and floats for another, but that's ugly and puts artificial constraints on our class. A constructor just isn't going to work. We could use a builder pattern, but that seems overkill for two parameters. Let's take a look at a new pattern in Java called static factory. The static factory is a simple variation of the factory method pattern. Factory method pattern is a design pattern we'll cover later. The static factory method is simply a static method that returns an instance of a class. It might call a constructor to create an instance, or it might return an instance it's already created. So our next thought is, how does that help us? So back to our earlier problem, let's look at creating our coordinate class. We could use a builder pattern here, but we've only got two parameters. It's either x, y, or distance and angle. Internally, we'll store only one. We'll go with x and y for the only reason we need to pick one. You don't ever want two representations of the same thing. You only want one truth in a system and then convert it to any other values. So, how do we create our coordinate instances? Since we can't have two constructors with the same parameter lists, we'll create two methods. One is called from xy and the other from polar. Both take two doubles and return a coordinate instance. We'll ignore any calculation errors. The polar method will convert to x and y and then create the coordinate. Our xy method just creates the coordinate. Here's the rub. How do we call these methods if we need an instance to call the method? Yeah, that's right. Make the method static. That's why they're called static factories. The other thing you want to do is make these methods final. We don't want new behavior for creation here. And finally, we want to make the constructor private. This enforces how instances of our classes are created. Okay, now we have a static factory. How did this help us? Well, for starters, we now have more meaningful names to create our classes. From x, y, and from polar make it clear what values are going into the creation of our instance. That's easier to read than a constructor name. We also have two ways to create our instances with the same parameter types. Both methods take two double values, but the meaning of those values are different in each case. If we had constructors, these two instantiations are the same. With static factory methods, it's clear how we're creating each instance and what the parameters mean. Another interesting advantage is conditional instantiation. That means we don't have to create a new object if we don't want to. Constructors must always return a new instance, even though the people at Java do break their own rules in a few cases, but that's another story. We talked about that in Tricky Numbers video. Anyways, if we're returning immutable objects, we might want to return the same one. Say, for example, we're using an integer coordinate system in a game that's only a 10 by 10. Each coordinate represents a single position in our game board that only has 100 positions. It'd be wasteful to keep creating instances for the same position. We could keep a pool of the coordinate instances, and then when you call the static factory, we'll just return the one you already created. Java does this with Boolean values. We might use a Boolean class in hundreds of places in an application, but there's only two instances. When you call value of true, you get the instances already created. So, sounds great. Why not use static factories everywhere? Well, we've seen that these classes are final. That means classes cannot be extended. You could move the factory into another class. This would allow you to create instances of subclasses, but I think a better plan is to use something called interfaces, and we'll talk about those later. The other problem is more of a readability issue. You can't tell the difference between a method and a factory method. They're syntactically equivalent. The best practice is to use method names that indicate what you're doing. Examples are like instance of, value of, and so on. So, that's another way to create an instance of your Java classes. We've covered constructors, builder patterns, constructor chaining, and static factories. Next, we're going to take a look at copy constructors. So, thanks for watching. If you have any questions, let me know in the comments. New lessons come out every week, so make sure you subscribe. You don't want to miss a video. Liking the video lets me know what I'm doing right, so if you like the video. And with that, I'll see you in the next tutorial.